Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the last video of this episode.
Episode 60.
We generally, almost always, typically end with the indie news segment. Starting on a somber note with this indie news segment, that one of the co-owners of AAW, Jim Lynham, passed away this week on the 4th, just after 1 a.m., due to an aortic dissection. And they rushed him into the hospital, and he didn't make it through the surgery to fix it, which was sort of devastating for everyone involved in AAW, because they had an upcoming show only, it was like five days post this tragic happening. I mean, he was only like 41 or 42 years old, something like that.
Yeah.
Very young. And not really, it took everybody by surprise because he wasn't showing any of the preliminary signs that people normally show when this occurs, because a lot of, you know, it's a major thing, so usually as soon as it happens, a lot of like physical chest pains start showing up right away. But I mean, according to what people are saying, is that he had only complained about feeling a little bit under the weather for the 2 days prior to this happening. So condolences to his family and everyone in the AAW crew and all the AAW wrestlers, and some of the people at PW Ponderings, because AAW was really one of the first promotions to open up to PW Ponderings and give them the time of day,
right,
and the credit they deserve, thanks to Jim. So rest in peace. But the show must go on, as wrestling always does. And we're going to start off with Ring of Honor on Destination America.
We are indeed. This was an episode with awesome bookends. We knew,
yes,
knew about the first and last match going into this show. We open up with the Young Bucks taking on War Machine. This started off just absolutely insane, automatically a tornado tag match, pretty much just so the Young Bucks could get as many super kick spots in as they possibly could.
Absolutely.
War Machine just being completely and utterly devastating. Some really cool, just demolishing double teams by these two. We get you know, just all kinds of chaos, which all culminates in a double dive spot by the Young Bucks. Matt dives out, Matt does the double kick to War Machine, and then does his little like
half skin the cat.
Yeah, half skin the cat, and then Nick dives over Matt onto both members of War Machine. But when he stands up, he's favoring his right ankle. Is having some issues.
Ends up not being able to put any weight on it.
Yeah, ref goes down to check on him. You know, the match kind of stops for a little bit, and then Ro just doesn't give a fuck. Grabs Matt and tosses him back in. AJ Styles, I guess you could say the leader of the Bullet Club currently.
Yeah, he's the leader.
Makes his way down to ringside, checks on Nick, realizes that he's not going to be able to make it in. He jumps up on the apron.
Takes Nick's place in the match.
So now we have Bullet Club taking on War Machine.
Yeah.
AJ gets a hot tag, just starts running crazy on both members of War Machine. Just some awesome spots from him, a great Rana on Ro, all kinds of stuff. Referee ends up getting taken out, and while this is happening, Nick Jackson, faking the injury, gets himself back in the ring. Super kicks both members of War Machine, set up AJ Styles to hit Raymond Rowe with the Styles Clash, and the Bullet Club / Young Bucks pick up the win. A crazy match, fun match, and a great way to kick off this episode of Ring of Honor.
It's awesome. I really love watching War Machine.
Yes.
Because they're a large tag team that has no problem keeping up with teams like Red Dragon and the Young Bucks and the Kingdom.
They're extremely quick for their size.
Very agile men.
Yeah.
Large, beardy, agile, lumberjack-like men.
We're going to meet in the middle of beardy men and quick, fast-paced men, because Adam Cole would be talking about his main event match against Kyle O'Reilly, talking about how, you know, on his end, there's no issues with the Kingdom after shaking hands with Kyle O'Reilly. Him and Kyle O'Reilly are pretty much best friends. You know, while he was out with injury, Kyle O'Reilly was calling him, making sure he was all right. He was the best man at Kyle O'Reilly's wedding. So they broke
into Ring of Honor together. They trained together. They were Future Shock together. You know, an awesome tag team for quite a while. And even their match after they split up together was like one of the Match of the Year candidates.
Yeah. So a rich history between these two guys. But the Kingdom isn't exactly okay with Adam Cole playing nicey-nice and shaking hands with Kyle O'Reilly after their six-man tag match last week. But Adam Cole is looking forward to tearing the house down again with Kyle O'Reilly in the main event.
Shouldn't be hard to do.
But before we get there, we have Cedric Alexander taking on the Romantic Touch. Caprice Coleman is at ringside, kind of giving his 2 cents about his issues with Cedric Alexander.
He's frustrated.
This match doesn't last very long because it's...
Like, at least he's not ignorant.
Does he have strength?
No, I don't
know. Cedric Alexander was in the driver's seat for most of this match. Romantic Touch does get a little bit of an advantage, but that ends up coming to an end when he's trying to get back in the ring. Veda ends up grabbing his leg, which kind of stops him. He kind of shoves Veda off, but that allows Cedric to kick the metal rope right into the lower ding-ding. Thank you, King.
King Carino.
He then hits the lumbar check on Romantic Touch, and Cedric Alexander picks up the win.
The win via ding-ding in the face.
What?
Did you not see the way Cedric Alexander was pinning Romantic Touch?
Oh,
he hit
yeah.
his ding-ding right in Romantic
he
Touch's face.
He did have
face.
His ding-ding right
he had
in
a
his
mask
face.
Full of ding-ding.
It was a romantic ding-ding.
It was.
The ding-ding touch. We had Veda Scott telling Cedric Alexander.
That's why Cedric Alexander was so mad.
we had Veda Scott get in and tell Cedric Alexander that, you know, he's getting all these things that he deserves.
Like the ding-ding touch.
And he knows what she wants, and it's for him to take the mask off and reveal that the Romantic Touch is Rhett Titus. He starts to go for the mask. Caprice Coleman gets in, tries to stop him. Cedric shoves him off pretty quick, but then it escalates and Moose comes running down, runs Cedric Alexander off. So Romantic Touch doesn't get his mask taken off, thankfully, with the help of Moose.
Yeah, and now we're gonna see CNC Moose Factory.
I don't think we're gonna get CNC.
That just could be Caprice and Clubman. His middle name is And.
Oh, okay. We had Jay Lethal and Truth Martini addressing the fact that Roderick Strong has been trying to get a rematch for the ROH title after their 1 hour Broadway at Death Before Dishonor. But Jay Lethal says, no, you have to go back to the end of the line.
There's a lot of other people that might deserve title matches, like Kyle O'Reilly's and Hanson's.
Which is funny because he's facing both those people.
Foreshadowing? Much?
What?
So the title smells like a chicken coop?
Yeah, they're gonna try and erase all the former champions because Jay Lethal is looking to be the greatest champion of all time.
That's a weird thing to say.
And then we have our main event, Kyle O'Reilly taking on Adam Cole. This was just awesome right from the get-go.
Yeah, they had a lot of really good exchanges right at the very beginning.
Headlock City, bitch.
And then from the beginning, after they had their great back and forth, it turned into Kyle O'Reilly and the land of 1,000 headlocks.
Yeah, just any and every way he could get a headlock on, he was doing it. And Adam Cole just couldn't get away from it.
But eventually on the outside, Adam Cole was able to shove him off of a headlock into the guardrail.
Yes.
Next to Christopher Daniels, who was on commentary.
Almighty Christopher Daniels.
And that kind of where things really took off.
Yeah,
match.
Christopher Daniels gets up, kind of starts yelling. at Kyle O'Reilly, and Adam Cole takes offense and shoves Christopher Daniels down. And Christopher Daniels is like, what the fuck? Adam Cole goes over and picks up Kyle O'Reilly, getting ready to get back into the match. But Christopher Daniels does a double clothesline from behind, knocks them both down. This causes a no contest. Things start getting crazy. It turns into, you know, a two-on-one beatdown on Daniels. And then Kazarian comes out and makes the save. And then Adam Cole throws out the challenge here, going, hey, why don't we get Future Shock back together for one night and beat these two old bastards? And Christopher Daniels in jeans and a t-shirt and Kazarian in his gear, they accept. And
well,
we have a tag
team. They take exception to being called old bastards.
They are old. I don't know if they're bastards, but they are
no,
old.
No, they don't believe they're old, but they sure as hell know they're bastards.
Oh. My bad. So we do get Future Shock versus The Addiction, and this is just even more awesome wrestling. Now,
yeah.
Now we're adding Christopher Daniels and Kazarian to the mix, and it's just an amazing tag team match. Four of probably the best, most talented guys on the indie scene right now. Ultimately, we have Kyle O'Reilly set up for Celebrity Rehab, but Cole is able to stop it by grabbing Christopher Daniels, hitting him with an O'Connor roll, and
after shoving him into Kazarian.
Yes, and picking up the win with the O'Connor roll. Then it turns into a beatdown again. Chris Sabin comes out, and we have all three members of the KRD beating down Future Shock. Bobby Fish makes the save, evens it up. They knock out the KRD, but then we get the really awkward moment of Maria Kanellis, Mike Bennett, and Matt Taven, the Kingdom, coming out and staring at Red Shock Future Dragon.
Yeah, and the crowd was chanting New Red Dragon.
Yeah. Yeah, so definitely...
Yeah, maybe Adam Cole will be added into the Red Dragons.
That could be cool.
Maybe.
I'm okay with that.
You know what would be really unlikely, but awesome?
If they both groups joined together.
Yeah. And that would make a great
team... The Kingdom of Future Dragon?
That would make a great team / stable to feud with the Bullet Club.
Ooh. It would. That's a good start right there. With the, just those six. That's I'm okay with that. But that's all I've got for Ring of Honor this week. We're gonna send it over to Kevin Hawk with more results.
All right. On the 8th, a few days later, we had Combat Zone Wrestling presents Retribution. from the Flyer Skate Park in Voorhees, New Jersey.
Always in the Voorhees.
And this was live on iPay-Per-View, as is now almost every single show CZW puts out.
We might be watching more CZW.
But we did have the pre-show that we had talked about previously.
Right.
Sozio versus Ryan Gallione at the front. If Sozio wins, he gets a 5-minute match with Trooper Audubon, the leader of the front. Sozio does defeat Ryan Gallione. He gets his 5-minute match with Trooper Audubon. If he wins, the front has to disband, and much to the celebration of the fans, Sozio wins after beating Trooper Audubon to a bloody pulp with a kendo stick, and the front is no more in CZW.
Wow.
And the fans rejoice.
Ah.
Also on the pre-show, we had JT Dunn defeat Joey Janela.
Nice.
If I remember correctly, David Starr came out post-match and attacked JT Dunn. They used to be tag team partners, formerly
right.
known as the Juicy Product.
Yeah.
And then we got on to the main card, where we started out with Penelope Ford and Takumi Iroja against Brittany Blake and Sumi Sakai. The first team, I said, won the match.
A really long, complicated one.
Fans say that the beginning of the match was slow and sloppy, but as things progressed, it picked up and got way easier to watch. Then we followed up with Dick Justice and Great Excellence going to a double knockout. Comedy match that was said to go way too long, and by the end of it, about 90% of the fans were bored.
Ouch.
And then we had The team of Chigusa Nagayo and Takaki Watanabe against Dub Security. The Japanese contingency ended up reigning supreme in this match after a harsh suplex-type maneuver onto one of Dub Security by Watanabe.
Ouch.
Then we had the first championship match of the night, the only scheduled championship match of the night, foreshadowing, where Tim Downs successfully defended the Wire Championship against Frankie Picard. Post-match, the former champion, Joe Gacy, came out and attacked Tim Downs, ran him out of the ring, and said that he's challenging him for the championship, challenging him for a rematch, but he's not challenging him to a wrestling match. He's going to kick his ass. It's going to be an ass-kicking, not a wrestling match, apparently.
Yeah.
You know.
The following contest is an ass-kicking match, scheduled for one fall.
And then we had the continuation of the war between the Nation of Intoxication and Ohio is for Killers, as we had a barbed wire board massacre match, which had a whole bunch of barbed wire boards in just about every literal incarnation of barbed wire board that they could come up with. They had the large, like, they had, like, the 2x4 style board. They had the large, like, sheet of, like, plywood kind of board. And even an ironing board.
What the fuck?
It was a barbed wire board massacre.
What the actual fuck?
And the only thing they didn't have was barbed wire that was bored.
I don't know. Did somebody ask the barbed wire if it was bored?
Who knows? Probably not, because this was Jake Crisp versus Danny Havoc. This match was short, but brutal. It ended
barbed wire.
While there was some interference going on, Dave Chris and Eric Ryan, the other members of Ohio's for Killers, came out, interfered, but then there was some saving graces from the Nation of Intoxication. They came out, kind of evened the odds out a little bit, and then Alex Colon made his return to CZW after being gone for a little while, revealing himself to be the fourth and final member of Ohio is for Killers.
Oh.
And ends up helping a little screw job action on Danny Havoc. Jake Crisp picks up the win. And then in the following match, Dave Crisp picks up a win over Connor Claxton of the Nation of Intoxication in a regular match. But it was because of a low blow.
Dick move, bro.
Literally.
That's it.
And then in the scheduled main event, we had Matt Tremont versus Pep Parks with Cherry Bomb in the Voorhees street fight. Also, the CZW champion Black G's came out and was in Pep Parks' corner. These guys are a little stable action, a little menage a trois, if you will. I don't know. Maybe.
Awkward.
Who knows? They're married, sort of. Except Black G's isn't married to them. Doesn't work like that, I don't think, unless you're in Colorado, or is it Utah, who knows. But Matt Tremont ends up picking the win up over Pepper Parks in this match. At one point, Pepper Parks gets backdropped onto Cherry Bomb and the guardrail.
What the fuck?
After the match, Matt Tremont challenges Black G's for the CZW Championship. Black G says, no, ain't gonna happen. No way. And then Matt Tremont says, all right, well, if you don't want to fight me, I'll give you my payout for tonight if you fight me for the championship. Black G's, always motivated by money, takes the deal, takes Matt Tremont's payout for the night to get a match against Matt Tremont. Tremont ends up beating Black G's and becoming your new CZW champion.
Holy shit.
And
I didn't
then,
see that coming.
Yeah, me either. But it's awesome. And it's always fun to hear about a surprise title change on the show.
Yeah, very nice.
And then we come the next day on the 9th. We had AAW's Bound by Hate from Marionette Park, Illinois.
Lots of good matches on this one.
Yeah, they started out with the 10 bell for Jim, who passed away a few days beforehand. Then the other owner of AAW, Double D, comes out and announces that next August, a year from now, AAW is going to be doing a two-day tournament in memoriam for Jim Lynham. And then Dan Lawrence came out and held a toast.
Very nice.
So a very classy way to open the show and show their respects.
Stay classy, AAW.
And then we start out with Candice LeRae defeating Allison Kay. ACH picked up a win over DJ Z. Davey Vega and Matt Fidget defeated Zero Gravity.
Matt Fidget.
Silas Young defeated Tommaso Ciampa. Lewis Linden successfully defended the Heritage Championship against former champion Christian Faith. Then we had the Hooligans and Buck Nasty defeat Ohio is for Killers and Heidi Lovelace. Johnny Gargano defeated Matt Sydal. And in the main event, in that street fight, we had Tyson Dux and Matt Cage defeat Eddie Kingston and Shane Hollister.
Nice.
And then an announcement that in the next show, we'll be seeing Trevor Lee at AAW.
Oh, very cool.
And Trevor Lee's awesome. If you
Double moonsault.
Check out the Caveman Stomp.
Double
that thing's gnarly.
Double moonsault makes me do this.
That's Andrew Everett. Little Pop.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Yeah,
what was it that Andrew Everett did that made me...
And Trevor Lee? I don't know. It is the Caveman Stomp, that double stomp where the person's running at him.
Oh, that's a fucked up move.
What's the other one he did?
There's another really flippy move he did. I don't remember. Scary.
Yeah. But that's it for results. A little bit of news heading your way. Do you have any news stories?
Nothing
have
really.
Have a quick touch on, despite it not being indie news, Roman Reigns,
yeah,
at a house show in, I think, was it Vancouver, British Columbia?
Something like that, yeah. Some douchebag
threw a Money in the Bank briefcase into the ring during his match with Bray Wyatt. He was kneeling in the ring,
yeah,
and he rainbowed it up over the top rope into the back of Roman Reigns' head.
Yeah. There's somebody got some pictures of it. There's videos surfacing of the security guards kicking the guy and his group out, and then fortunately, Roman Reigns was all right. Him and Bray Wyatt continued their match, but still, why the fuck are you throwing stuff in the ring?
Yeah, and the part that makes me even the most mad about this is how dumb the guy was, because apparently after the matches of the show, he was getting the wrestlers to sign his briefcase.
You're a fucking moron.
If you have a Money in the Bank replica briefcase and you're getting wrestlers to sign it, why are you going to throw it in the middle of the ring in the main event when you know it's going to be confiscated?
You're stupid.
WWE Auction is going to sell that off now. They're going to Money in the Bank replica with wrestler signatures on it.
I would hope they just give it to Roman Reigns and there's just a picture of him on Twitter going. Other than that, I don't really have any updates as far as Figures Toy Company. Nothing new announced post Michael Elgin, but if you go to Figure Toys Company's Twitter at Figures Toy Co, you can see the pre stages, the sculptures of both Joey Ryan and Blue Meanie. Pictures are up.
Their faces.
Yeah, just the faces.
Which, by the way, faces look really creepy when they're all one color.
When they're all just grayscale.
Yeah, like if you don't put color on a face, it's weird looking.
Yeah. Blue Meanie looks really good. Joey Ryan looks a little funky, but I'm sure once the color's added, I'm sure it'll look a little bit better.
So.
But yeah, I don't really have anything for news. What you got?
We had a thing happen. We didn't really touch on it because it happened so fast, but Jerry Lynn...
Right.
Required neck surgery and fusing some of his vertebrae, which would keep him out of work for a few months. Somebody started a GoFundMe campaign to help him pay for his medical expenses and also expenses to, take care of everything, bills and groceries and whatnot, while he'd be out of work for 2 to 3 months.
Yeah, and that's a long time to go with. I mean, if you're an independent wrestler, I mean, you're getting paid on a show-to-show basis.
But I mean, he's retired now, though. So he's actually working.
Oh, he's actually working a job now.
He's working, So, I mean...
But still.
No
one get workman's comp for it.
No one's going to get, you know... It, taking 2 to 3 months off, you know, it's going to take a toll on you financially.
That's a big
especially
thing
when you have a family.
Yes.
So the goal for the GoFundMe was set at $15,000. With everything that was going to go past $15,000 would end up going to the Nashville Rescue Mission, which helps with all sorts of issues of like clothes and food to the homeless. And in a matter of like about a week, they surpassed their goal.
Nice.
They made $17,585 as of the last update, with 501 people donating. Lots of people, and a lot of people that you might recognize the names of, such as Steve Carino, Kevin Kelly, Christopher Daniels, Adam Cole, Chris Jericho, Mick Foley, Austin Aries, Eric Young, Lita, Magnus, Scott D'Amore, and Charles Robinson.
Wow.
A lot of wrestlers pitching in.
No joke.
Which is awesome. Because Jerry Lynn is a rad dude, and everyone wants to see Jerry Lynn be awesome some more in his post-wrestling life.
So have they closed the GoFundMe? Or
no, the GoFundMe is going to keep going, and it's still all the proceeds from here on out are going to the Nashville Rescue Mission.
Any idea how long they're keeping it open?
No idea. As long as they want.
That's awesome.
But it's all going to a good cause.
Yeah. I mean, we've already got what we needed. We're getting Jerry Lynn the help that he needs. And now it's all just about helping other people.
Yeah. Also, another thing, I don't know if it's GoFundMe, but after this had so much success, Joey Styles had posted on his Twitter that there is another online campaign going on now for Axl Rotten.
This was I actually knew about this prior to the Jerry Lynn, because Axl Rotten was on Talk Is Jericho, and Jericho has been plugging Axl Rotten's GoFundMe.
It is a GoFundMe campaign.
Yeah.
Basically, it's a GoFundMe campaign to make Axel's house wheelchair accessible.
Yeah, because unfortunately he has the inability to walk. He's doing physical therapy a couple times a week. He's getting some strength back, but he still can't do much on his own. Be sure, you know, go back, listen to Talk As Jericho on podcast1.com, and you can hear the story from Axl Rotten himself.
Yeah. So guys, go on, donate, help out.
Help some wrestlers.
You know, they need the love.
Wrestlers need help too.
You know, it takes a toll. And, you know, they did it for us and you. They did it for the fans. So now it's our turn to give back to the wrestlers. Which is a cool thing, because back when I was young, I was always like, you know, it'd be cool if something could happen where, you know, we could help entertain the wrestlers or whatnot, something we could give back. And now with things like Kickstarter, GoFundMe, social media in general, we now have a way that we can be more interactive with wrestlers and give back to them in that fashion.
It's very cool.
Also, update on our favorite wrestling weekend of the year.
Chikara!
King of Trios, the bracket are in the process of being filled, because the 16th and final team has been announced.
Yes, it has.
It is Battleborn, consisting of Kevin Condren, Juke Joint Lucas Calhoun, and Missile Assault Man, if that's his real name.
I hope it's not. I'm
okay with that.
I want him to change his name.
And they are rounding out the King of Trios tournament.
Yeah,
I guess, which is awesome. Yeah. We now have all 16 teams announced.
Lots of interesting teams.
There's the Bullet Club, AJ Styles and the Young Bucks. Mm-hmm. Team AAA, represented by Phoenix, Dragon, and Aerostar. There's the BWO, Big Stevie Cool, the Blue Guy, and Hollywood Nova. Mm-hmm. There's, which one are these guys? Team Attack Pro Wrestling, with Pete Dunne, Mandrews, and Morgan Webster, along with Team Fight Club Pro with MK McKinnon and Mustache Mountain.
Mustache, 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 mustache,
Okay.
Who's number six?
Then we get all the Chikara teams.
Right.
The COTI guys.
Yeah. Starting with the Devastation Corporation, last year's reigning champions, last year's runner-ups, Icarus and the Throwbacks. We've got Amasis and the Colony from the Battle Hive. We have Ophidian, Shinron, and Eddie Kingston representing the Snake Pit. We have Princess Kimberly and Los Ice Creams representing Crown of Court. We've got the Batiri and Oleg representing the Arcane Horde. We've got Juan Francisco de Coronado, the Proletariat Bora Moldova, and Mr. Azerbaijan representing the United Nations. We've got Hollow Wicked, Frightmare, and Silver Ant representing the Nightmare Warriors. We have Chuck Taylor, Drew Gulak, and Swamp Monster representing the Gentleman's Club.
We have Battleborn that we just talked about.
We do. And what's the COTI team I'm missing out on?
The fucking BDK.
Yeah, the BDK team. Yakum Hammermeyer, Knockin, and Soldier Ant.
Yes. Soldier Ant's scary.
I almost said Slinky Ant.
That would be... What the... I don't even know what that gimmick would be.
It would be great.
Slinky
you know
Ant.
Scary. Those teams. And also, the first two competitors for Rey de Voladores have been announced.
Ooh.
We have Mascara Purpura
from
Mexico and M-Dog 20 Matt
Ross.
Oh,
yeah.
And he's been in Rey de Voladores before.
Yes.
So he's coming back and hopes to win it this time.
I'm pulling for Matt Cross.
So far, maybe there's going to be better people in it. Maybe ACH is coming back.
Shit, then I won't be able to decide.
Well, I'll probably go with ACH because he's my favorite.
Absolutely. And that's it for news on my end.
That's,
we got a lot of upcoming shows to get you ears filled with. Starting with the 14th, coming up only in a few days, we have Absolute Intense Wrestling Battle of the Sexes.
Battle.
From the Holiday Inn in Strongsville, Ohio. A lot of awesome things happening at this show I'm excited about. Athena is going against a mystery opponent. Gregory Iron versus Antisocial. Lewis Linden versus Heidi Loveless. Ethan Page versus Allison Kay. The team of Two Infinity, Cheech and Colin, are taking on Sugar and Spice, Taylor Hendricks and Mary Elizabeth Monroe.
Taylor Hendricks.
Ricky Shane Page is going against Veda Scott. Madman Pondo versus Crazy Mary Dobson. Eddie Kingston versus Mia Yim. And Johnny Gargano versus Candice LeRae. If you're excited about this match, check out the other match AIW has posted.
Great
match.
Yeah.
Of Johnny Gargano's. Johnny Gargano's LeRae.
You, if they weren't dating before, you just shipped them. That was great.
Don't use that word.
Garganus.
Fucking stupid.
Gargandus.
That's their baby's name.
That was awesome. Oh, God, don't name your child Gargandus.
The next day on the 15th.
That's a comic book name.
Talk about our boys at Chikara.
Chikara!
In Philly at the new and improved Wrestle Factory.
Yeah.
We're bringing you the good life. We got some singles action that's just been recently announced. Oleg the Usurper is going to take on Prakash Sabar. And Argus is going to take on the Proletariat Bor of Moldova.
Right.
Then we have what we talked about last week. We have the Crown and Court being represented by Los Ice Creams taking on the Nightmare Warriors, Blind Rage, and Frightmare. And
gee,
then
I wonder.
The Grand Championship match. Hollow Wicked defends against the Osirian Portals, Amasis, the Funky Pharaoh, cashing in 3 points.
Hell yeah.
Trying to make Chikara history.
Man, we talked about this last week, and I'm gonna freak the fuck out. If Amasis wins the Grand Championship, then the Snake Pit ends up winning King of Trios.
That would be great.
I'm gonna lose it.
That'd be an awesome year capper for the Osirian Portal.
Yeah, it would.
And then on the same day, we have Evolve 47 from Queens, New York. The premier athlete brand being represented by Caleb Conley and Tony Nese is going to have an open challenge. We also have Biff Busick versus Hot Sauce Tracy Williams. Trent Beretta is going against Ray Horace. Chris Hero versus Mike Bailey. Rich Swann versus Drew Gulak. Johnny Gargano versus Ethan Page in an Anything Goes match and a main event for the Evolved Championship as Timothy Thatcher defends against Zack Sabre Jr. And then on Sunday the 16th, we have Evolve 48 from Deer Park, New York, where there's going to be another premier athlete brand. This time, with it'll be Conley and Nice accompanied with Trent Barretta doing an open challenge. And then we're going to have Drew Gulak and Tracy Williams versus Ray Horace and Speedball Mike Bailey. Ethan Page is going to go against Rich Swann. Johnny Gargano is going to go against an opponent of Ethan Page's choosing. We're going to have Chris Hero versus Zack Sabre Jr. and a no-holds-barred match between Timothy Thatcher and Biff Busick.
That's going to be rough.
And then we've got a couple dates for Ring of Honor.
We do indeed.
Question mark?
On the 21st in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the 2300 Arena, Ring of Honor finishes off their Aftershock tour. We got a six-man tag match that was just announced. We have the Briscoes teaming up with Haruki Goto, taking on Team Chaos, RPG Vice, and Okada. We have Kushida taking on Matt Sydal. We have Adam Cole taking on Nakamura. And in the main event, we have the rematch.
Go figure, because they were just talking about it in Ring of Honor.
We have the rematch. Jay Lethal defends the Ring of Honor World Championship against
Roderick Strong.
Then, the following day, on the 22nd, we have Field of Honor. There was a new match just announced to this. I think you're going to be excited about this one.
No, I'm not.
All right, fine. I won't talk about it.
No, you got to say it so I can pretend that I'm extra excited now.
We have RPG Vice teaming with the Kingdom. Eight-man tag team action taking on the Young Bucks, Matt Sydal, and ACH. That is one flippy team. Other matches, we have Christopher Daniels, almighty Christopher Daniels, taking on Adam Cole. We have Haruki Goto taking on Michael Elgin. We have Killer Elite Squad taking on War Machine. Okada taking on Roderick Strong. We have Jay Lethal and Nakamura taking on Red Dragon. And we have the Briscoes taking on the Time Splitters.
Yeah. A lot of good tag team stuff happening there.
No joke. And then the following week, on the 29th, Ring of Honor is starting their Reloaded Tour. This will start in Norcross, Georgia. We have a six-man tag match has been announced. It'll be Jay Lethal and The Addiction taking on Adam Cole and Red Dragon. And I believe you have some upcoming shows after the tour, or starting on the 29th, correct?
Starting on the 28th.
Oh!
On Friday, the 28th, a day late, hopefully not another short, because we're talking about one of the biggest tournaments in professional wrestling today. That is the Battle of Los Angeles.
PWG!
In Reseda, California. Brought up to you by those guys you just said.
Them guys.
PWG. So straight up, we're going to have half the first round matches in stage one on Friday. The second half of the first round matches will be on stage two on Saturday, and then the quarterfinals, semifinals, and finals will all be held on stage three on Sunday.
Nice.
So just take a listen to some of these matches that are going to be in the first round.
If you know the lineup for Bola, I can only imagine what type of match. I don't even know. So I'm. This is going to be like you're going to see my like live. Well, not live, but. In the moment reactions. Let's do this.
All right. First match up is going to be Aerostar versus Cage.
Sorry, Aerostar.
Then we have Biff Busick versus Andrew Everett.
That'd be good.
Mark Andrews versus Will Ospreay. Drago versus Pentagon Jr.
Fuck yeah.
Trent Barretta versus Trevor Lee.
Ooh.
And Phoenix versus Matt Sydal.
Oh, shit.
Also slated in non-tournament action for stage one, we're going to have a six-man tag team match. Tommy End, Zack Sabre Jr., and Marty Scurll, representing the UK, are going to be taking on the team of Roderick Strong and the Young Bucks, representing Mount Rushmore.
Ooh,
2.0.
Nice.
And then also, we're going to have in tag team action the team of Angelico and...
Angelico.
Angelico. I'm G-ing it up, bro. Like a real G. and Yak Evans.
He just said that.
Angelico and Yak Evans.
You're gonna piss me off.
Okay. Angelico and Jack Evans.
Yeah, there we go. That's better.
Are gonna be taking on the Inner City Machine Guns, Rich Swann and Ricochet.
Oh my fucking god.
And that's not it, that's halfway. Because the next day on Saturday we got stage two.
Shit!
We got Marty Skrull versus Rich Swann, Chris Hero versus Timothy Thatcher, and Helico taking on Jack Evans in the first round.
Alright, do it.
Tommy End versus Drew Gulak, Mike Bailey versus Drew Galloway,
ooh,
and Ricochet versus Zack Sabre Jr.
That's going to be a fucking good match.
And then in non-tournament action, we have a AAA tag team match as Aerostar and Phoenix take on Drago and Pentagon Jr. And then
Lucha Underground Season 2.
The team of Biff Busick, Andrew Everett, and Trevor Lee will take on the Young Bucks and Super Dragon, representing Mount Rushmore 2.0.
Man, that's going to be a good fucking weekend.
And then on Sunday, all the next rounds of the tournament will happen, and we'll crown a new champion of the Bola.
Yeah.
Not Ebola, the Bola.
The Bola. And Battle of Los Angeles, motherfucker.
The Battle of Los Angeles in Reseda.
Because that makes sense.
On Canby Street. It's funny, because Canby's a town from where we're from. And then also on the 30th, the same day that the Battle of Los Angeles ends, Beyond Wrestling brings us the Battle of New England Returns. Tell everybody the acronym that spells
it's,
out.
It's down there.
Is it down there?
Oh, yeah.
It's
yeah.
I see it now.
Yeah.
It's funny. But, I mean, two awesome matches that we announced last week that we're excited about. A.R. Fox versus Jonathan Gresham and Nick Gage versus Sugar Dunkerton. But then we've added a bunch of Battle of New England Returns challenge matches.
Just call it what they are.
The Boner Challenge matches from Team Pazuzu. So we have mystery opponent for Pinky Sanchez in a one-on-one match.
All right.
And then both EYFBO and the Doom Patrol, a.k.a. Chris Dickinson and Jaka, both have mystery opponent tag team matches.
Ooh.
And then the match you're excited about is going to pit Joey Ryan against Katrina.
I want to be Joey.
Lucha Underground.
I want to be Joey Ryan so bad, I want to put my lollipop.
Carly Perez.
Yeah, that's yeah. I want to put my lollipop in her mouth.
Yeah, Joey Ryan, the blow pop versus the liquor.
Joey Ryan, you lucky son of a bitch.
And then you have some stuff from early September?
Yeah, not a lot. We do have, okay, so starting the 11th, we're going to keep going with the Reloaded Tour. There's no matches announced for the 11th or the 12th. That'll be in Dearborn, Michigan, and Chicago Ridge, Illinois. But then on the 18th, we have the All-Star Extravaganza Night 1, where we still only have the two matches that we announced last week. Kyle O'Reilly will take on whomever is the world champion, either Roderick Strong or Jay Lethal. And Bobby Fish will take on the TV champion, whether it's Jay Lethal. Jay Lethal's got a couple defenses coming up. So whoever is the champion will face Bobby Fish at All-Star Extravaganza. Then the next night, on the 19th, we have Extravaganza Part 2. No matches announced for that. But there's a lot of shows in September for Ring of Honor. So we got a lot of TV tapings, lots of big shows coming up for them.
Yeah, and then also on the 12th, we have a doubleheader. These are getting popular. Doubleheader with CZW and WSU. That's going to be on the 18th, or on the 12th, from Voorhees, New Jersey. And then on the 18th, AAW's next show, Defining Movement, from Marionette Park, Illinois. And that show is the one we know that will feature Trevor Lee.
Nice.
That's it for upcoming events. That's a lot of upcoming events. That was a lot of matches to put in your ear holes.
Okay, remind me of the dates of Bola.
That's Bola.
It's the last weekend of August, right?
Yeah, that's the 28th, 29th, and 30th.
Now, like 4 days later, 5 days later, King of Trios starts.
Yeah.
Holy shit! That's two awesome tournaments, like, a week apart.
Yeah.
I love independent wrestling.
Back to back. Fantastic stuff. Join us next week here on the Indie News. We should give you the first match, or better, maybe a few matches announced for the King of Trios tournament.
Absolutely.
And results from Battle of the Sexes and Chikara's The Good Life.
Yeah, I don't think I won't have any results for next week.
And possibly
week.
Both Evolve shows.
We will have results from this coming week's Ring of Honor TV. We'll see what kind of fallout we had from the awkward situation between the new Red Dragon and the Kingdom.
Yeah.
See what happens there. But yeah, indie news is on. Independent wrestling is on fire right now.
It has been for the last like year, 2 years, 3 years. It's got a big resurgence.
It's awesome.
And we
lots
love every
shit.
Second of it.
Thanks
every
again for
minute,
watching.
Second, like, favorite, subscribe.
And if you want to keep up with all the guys we just talked about, links down in the description.
Holy crap, like ProWrestlingGorilla.com.
And like Ring of Honor Wrestling.
And LookMondoFans.com. That'll take you to Beyond Wrestling.
ChikaraPro.com.
Chikara Pro. What about AA Wrestling? Or AI Wrestling? Or
yeah.
CZ Wrestling?
There's also DGUSA.TV.
And WWN Live.
There is that as well. Also, below that are links to all of our stuff. You got Facebook, you got Twitter, you got Tumblr, you got Instagram, you got Reddit, you have emails. You can talk to all of us at fanstockwrestling@gmail.com, or you can talk specifically to this guy at kevin_hawk636@hotmail.com.
Yeah, chat with the dude with the beard.
And talk shit about me, apparently, because that's what that email's for.
Uh-huh.
That and spoilers.
And the playlist. Check out the playlist. This is the last video of the week, so you got a stacked playlist right there. You got Raw Review, Midweek Wrap-Up, SmackDown Rundown, this Indie News,
yeah,
and the five misses not to match. No, that sounds wrong.
No, it's...
The five matches not to miss, Hot Rod, Roddy Piper edition. There
yeah,
he is, check that guy.
Yeah.
He's cool.
Some cool links down in the description of that one. A couple of matches, a highlight music video, an interview with Greg Valentine and Roddy Piper about their match. Awesome stuff. Go check it out. Thanks for watching. Thanks for liking. Thanks for sharing. We'll see you guys next week for episode 61.
Hell yeah.
Hey, huh? 8 years old? 9. Oh, happy birthday. Luke, right? It's so nice to meet you, man. What was your name? Jason?
Jeff.
He was a J. Hey, thank you so much for bringing him out today to this show. Thank you so much, guys.
Let's do it. What do you think, guys? What do you think?